seen anything like it. Charlie took it to the extreme. Every piece of wooden panel that was cut for each window looked like it had been custom fit. The holes for the doorknobs on the French doors were meticulously cut, perfectly round circles.
As one might expect from an engineer, Charlie Brandt worked as a radar technician. Inside his house, things were just as precise. The first shot came when investigator Rob Hemmert stepped into the Brandt's bedroom.
There's this huge poster on the back of the bedroom door that I couldn't believe I'd found.
A graphic poster of the female anatomy in plain view.
Her hair's put up in a bun, which I had never seen before. And it's showing the skeletal system and the muscular system.
This is something that Terry would have seen every day.
Absolutely.
What do you make of that?
It just makes me wonder, why? You know, did she not think it was a big deal? Charlie and Terry were not in the medical profession. We saw no reason for that chart to be there. What is this doing in someone's home?
Hemmert had an unsettling answer to his own question.
I'm looking at a chart that's got the portions of the body exposed, and he's virtually duplicated or exposed some of those areas of the body in what he did with Michelle.
And there were other eerie reminders.
Medical books, journals, an anatomy book. And in that book, there was a newspaper clipping that showed a human heart, knowing what he did to Michelle and then finding those things. It all started to make sense.
As soon would the Victoria's Secret catalogs found in the house, addressed to Charlie Brandt.
He always referred to Michelle as Victoria's Secret. He gave her that name, and he never referred to her as Michelle.
Far from being just a friendly uncle, to the horror of the Jones family, Charlie Brandt had been secretly infatuated with his niece. The idea that Charlie would use this phrase in reference to your daughter.
I know, just with a problem.
How would Michelle have responded? How would she have reacted if she had known that?
She'd have been livid.
That would have been the height of betrayal.
You know, you don't warn your kids about their uncle.
I think he was obsessed with her, fascinated by her, and I think ultimately, he intended on killing her. And I think that's evident in the way he spoke about her and the things that he looked at on the internet.
When investigators examined Brandt's computer, they found he'd been on ghastly websites featuring death fantasies, necrophilia, and violence against women. You can't look at this and obviously not think about what he did. This is sort of like a training manual.
You see where he may have got some of his ideas and thoughts and fantasies from. The thing that we noted immediately was that the things that he did with her body did not appear to be someone who had done this for the first time. There had to be more.
Hemmert was sure that if he looked hard enough, he would find evidence that, in fact, Charlie Brandt was a serial killer. His only real question, how many other victims were there?
From went fishing, caught a good bull dolphin, to nice dinner with Charlie.
With few hints of anything wrong.
We only found a couple of interesting notations, and those were weird day, but there's nothing any more specific, and we have no idea what occurred that would have caused her to write that.
Terry also noted times when Charlie was out late, even out all night, again, with no explanation.
Terry tended to be more of the life of the party, and he was just kind of like this strong, quiet guy.
Musician Jim Graves palled around with Charlie in the 80s when he was married to Brandt's sister, Angela. He will never forget the day that she confided in him that decades before, Charlie had killed their pregnant mother.
I came home one day and she was crying rather uncontrollably and said she had something that she absolutely had to talk to me about.
But Jim says that after getting to know him, it seemed clear that whatever had happened years before, Charlie was okay now.
He was so gentle that when there was a bug in the house, he would refuse to step on it and carry it outside.
Today, Graves regrets that he didn't pay more attention, especially to one time after he and Angela split up and the two men got to talking.
We were having a few beers after fishing all day and everything, and I was just really despondent. Somehow we started talking about revenge. You know, you get your feelings hurt and you want to lash out. But I believe he looked at me and said, well, if you really want to get revenge, you should kill somebody and cut their heart out.
Kill somebody and cut their heart out?
Yeah. And it creeped me out at the time.
I was going to say.
Oh, sure, because I was like, whoa.